Hi, my name is Kristin Lauter, and I'm a principal researcher at Microsoft Research. So when I was young, I was very lucky that my father liked to teach me math, especially in the car. We would do arithmetic and story problems when I was very, very young. And so I always enjoyed that. That was a great pleasure. And I was good at it. And so I got a lot of positive reinforcement. He always laughed that he would tell me story problems in the car, and I would answer the problem even before he finished asking it. So that was a lot of fun, even though I'm not sure it's such a good idea to answer the question before it's finished being asked. Well, really, I had no idea that I wanted to become a mathematician. I didn't really even know that there was such a profession, but I love to learn. And when I went to the University of Chicago, the mathematics program was just so inspiring and engaging that I really got interested in it then. And it was actually when I was a junior in college. My professor, who was our honors algebra professor for abstract algebra, called me aside and talked to me about possibly applying to graduate school. And that was really the first time that I even thought of it as an option or knew it was an option. And so with his encouragement, I did apply to graduate school. And in fact, I went back to the University of Chicago for graduate school, and he was my advisor. So that was great. I do number theory and algebraic geometry. That was my graduate training, and I loved pure mathematics during graduate school. Number theory is not so much about numbers, but actually studying a lot of abstract concepts that are created by mathematicians. I like to think of mathematics and mathematical research as a kind of a language where we create objects, sometimes from our imagination, and then we prove theorems or relationships between them. And in some cases, that actually relates back to the real world, and in this case, to numbers and geometric objects, and other times, not so much. But in algebraic geometry, there are objects called elliptic curves, which are curves. So they're a geometric object, kind of, you know, thinking of a curve in the plane. But they're also, they are a very old mathematical object that was defined more than 100 years ago. And they have a special property, which is that points on the curve, you can also operate on them. So you can take two points and you can add them together by passing a line through and looking for the next point of intersection with the curve. And so it's a very beautiful object because it has both an algebraic and a geometric structure to it. And it so happens that these are used in cryptography. And so when I went to Microsoft Research, I was very happy to shift the focus of my research towards elliptic curve cryptography. And I worked on that for many years. So another topic that I worked on once I went to Microsoft Research is privacy. And cryptography provides us tools for protecting privacy. And in particular, I worked on homomorphic encryption, which allows us to create an encryption scheme that is very useful for protecting privacy, because you can encrypt data, but you can still operate on that encrypted data. So for example, you can apply computations such as machine learning computations, for example, which is the foundation for AI, artificial intelligence. And working on privacy and machine learning led me into a lot of really interesting areas in ML and AI, some of which have to do with bioinformatics computations and other areas of ML, and even into issues of responsible AI and fairness in AI. And all of these areas involve a lot of different kinds of mathematics. So even though I started out very abstractly working on algebra and number theory and algebraic geometry, over the course of a 25-year career, I've moved into other areas, and I very much enjoy being motivated by applications and using all different fields of mathematics to make progress on societal problems. So when I went to the University of Chicago as an undergraduate, I was very young. I graduated from high school when I was 15 years old. And one of my biggest challenges was socially not fitting in. But when I went to the University of Chicago, I was tested into the honors calculus sequence. And the professor for my course was Jill Pfeiffer, who is the recent president of the American Mathematical Society. But honors calculus at the University of Chicago is very theoretical. And so after a few weeks, I went and I told her, I had my little drop slip that I wanted her to sign. I told her that I needed to drop the class. And she said, oh, well, why do you want to drop the class? And I said, well, I don't know what all of these epsilon and deltas are. And she said, well, that's okay. Nobody else does either. And she wouldn't sign the slip. So I couldn't drop the class. And it was just so great that I love to tell this story because it just shows that you've got a lot of, you know, young people, especially young women, who don't have a lot of confidence and don't necessarily know what they're getting into and are not sure that they want to study mathematics in particular. And it's very easy to lose those people. It could have lost me just if she had just signed that piece of paper. But that kind of encouraging, you know, friendly voice and friendly tone helped me to persist. And I did well in the class throughout the year and kept on studying mathematics after that. I think the thing that I'm the most proud of in my career is having been AWM president from 2015 to 2017 and all of the programs that we were able to start during that time to support women and girls and careers in mathematics. And I actually got into the AWM and the role in the leadership because of my work on starting the Women in Numbers Network, going back to earlier in my career in 2006 with Renata Scheidler and Rachel Preece. So we were motivated at that time to try to increase the visibility of women in number theory. I had had my PhD for 10 years, and I was really tired of going to number theory conferences that had no women speakers or almost no women speakers, or if I was the only one. And I thought that it was ridiculous because I could count that there were, you know, more than 75 women in number theory that I knew of that were postdoc or beyond. So why weren't any of them, you know, speaking at these conferences I was going to? So Women in Numbers was an attempt to build a research community, and we designed it as collaborative research conferences, which we now call Research Collaboration Conferences for Women, RCCWs. And even before becoming AWM president, I was able to help get a number of other research networks started in other areas. And then as AWM president, we were able to get a five-year NSF advance grant to support the research networks. And we set up several committees, and I've continued to work on this initiative for many years now. And we now have more than 22 different research networks for women in different areas. And we have a publication series with Springer, and we've published about that number of volumes of research articles from these different networks. And so it's very exciting. So all in all, this is definitely the accomplishment that I'm most proud of in my career. Well, I was very lucky to have Jill Pfeiffer as my first year honors calculus professor when I was in college at the University of Chicago. And that was wonderful because I had quite literally never had a female math teacher or professor up till that point. And I never had another one either, ever. So she was the only one. But when I got to be in my later in my professional career, both as an assistant professor at the University of Michigan and then later as a researcher at Microsoft Research, I also really didn't have any women role models. And that at that time, it's funny because it's almost like you don't realize that you don't have any until you find one, and then you see what an amazing impact she can have on your career. So at Microsoft Research, Jennifer Chase was the person that really became a role model and a mentor, and eventually actually my manager And she still is a mentor for me. So she started several new research labs for Microsoft Research. So the New England lab in Boston and the New York lab. So she's been a great role model for at least the last 10 or 15 years for me. I like to think of mathematics as the practice of thinking clearly. And I'd really like to emphasize that as a thinking human being, you can learn anything that you want to learn. So I really think that all of us as human beings should be spending our whole lives learning. And that means a couple of things. First of all, it means if you think you can learn anything and your goal is to keep learning, then as you go through life and as you go through your career, if you have a career in mathematics, you can change your focus. And that is something that a lot of professional mathematicians might not realize, that you don't have to just work on only one area of mathematics throughout your career. Something that makes it a lot easier to learn is if people explain things clearly. So I place a very high value on clear communication. And often it takes a lot of thought and work to explain something clearly. And sometimes I think it's an undervalued quality in mathematics is the power of good teaching and the power of clear explanation. But in fact, in other jobs outside of academia, it's actually very highly valued. It's equally important to actually ask questions. And so I think that in mathematics lectures that we should be interrupting more and asking more questions, clarifying questions. And in collaborations, we shouldn't let our collaborators get away with bluffing, you know, some statements that may or may not be correct. If you don't understand, if you can't see the proof of something, then you should be asking at the earliest possible point. So asking clarifying questions is both really important and it can also save us, you know, time and effort. So if we all work together to change our culture and appreciate questions in lectures, then I think we can improve things together. Social science studies shows that people really overestimate, like if they make any progress and they hire like one woman or one minority, then they really overestimate their progress and their achievement. Like, oh, well, we solved that problem. We don't need to do it anymore. Yeah. But remember, 50%, that's the goal. Happy International Women's Day, by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah. And remember, the goal is 50%.